to the side. You'd better run and hide. Mine to the side. Everybody wants to stay alive. Set to the side. You'd better run and hide. Mine to the side. Everybody wants to stay alive.
What is your major malfunction?
Welcome to the ChabDog Sports Talk Radio Show. Sunday mornings live from 9 to 11 a.m. Pacific. Where spontaneous sports talk rated R.
Don't make a fuck out of me.
Host Brandon Chabner and producer Eric the Well Read bring you Brian from Sports Rock.
Say hello to my little friend.
And Tank's West Coast godbrother, Abe Miranda.
You see, the Mets are the true passion of New York.
Plus special guests, music, movie clips, comedy.
So fat, the blood type is red goo.
And always a little politics.
It comes from China.
The live call-in number is 252-585-4120. Join in the fun.
Hello.
And now, here's your host, ChabDog.
Thank you.
Mic check. Did we do that?
Yeah. We're doing it live.
I guess we're doing it live. A live mic.
We'll do it live.
Great. Well, anyway, making July an incredible month. We've got another show that's going to be broadcast visually. So you got that new thing going on. You got a lot of things changing right now in the middle of one of the best months of the year. This is the Buckwheaties Pancakes Breakfast of Champions show. Took me a while to get that out. But I think that is appropriate right now, given what's going on in the NBA with the Milwaukee Bucks. And this show is brought to you by Chapter Law, serving Southern California's business and transactional legal needs. And we've been doing that since way back in 2007. And also by ChabDog Sports Blog for your head of your sports headlines and biting sports commentary. And got a few things to be talking about right now in the world of sports. With, did you see Game 5 last night, Eric? My co-host Eric Sova is here.
With me. Hey, ChabDog.
Yeah, so all-important Game 5 happened last night, and a lot of people think that in a seven-game series, Game 5 is the game you've got to win. I don't know about that because that didn't work that well for the Nets against the Bucks. They won Game 5 and then lost the last two. But it was quite a good game, I thought. These teams are flawed, but they're well matched for each other, don't you think, Abe?
Yeah, I think it's been an interesting journey. Yes.
Abe it's Miranda.
Been my co-host, Abe Miranda.
Hey.
The racing guru.
Well, a lot of gurus on this show, and but yes, I think it's been an interesting match so far, especially as far as Arizona has come. It's incredible to see this final play out the way it is. Giannis is he's a monster, dude. So I mean, I think he's gonna have a, you know, I like the fact that. They've got Phoenix kind of running for the hills a little bit on that.
Mm-hmm. And Phoenix needed to face some adversity. They really haven't. And so this is going to be the test of their manhood. Like the Bucks have already been through the wars. They got through the Nets in 7. Giannis got hurt, and they still survived that against the Hawks. And then they fall behind 2-0. It reminds me a lot of you know what reminds me of? It reminds me of the Dodgers in the early 80s when they couldn't beat the Yankees in the 70s. You know, they kept getting the World Series and falling short, and people were calling them losers. And then they lost the first two games in that series against New York, went back to New York because they blew those games in Los Angeles, I think. And so it looked like there's no way. They're gone. But basically, that was the worst it got, and after that, they won 4 straight, and you have to go through adversity to get to the promised land, and that's just almost always true in sports, and the Suns haven't really had to face that. So now we'll see.
Yeah, I think they're really facing an actual worthy opponent at this time, and of course, I mean, to come from behind and do what they did in the with the Bucks. It's been amazing. And you know, Giannis was just he was on a press conference not too long ago. I want to say maybe yesterday or the day before, where he was talking about how, you know, he's trying to suppress a lot of his pride and his ego when he goes into these games. Like, you know, if he looks behind in the rearview mirror and he looks at all the other games, he calls that, you know, his ego. You know, if you're looking back at all the games you've won and how you've got there, then that's ego. But
yeah, and that's not that relevant other than it does give you confidence. I mean, he can look back on what he's done.
Well, that's what he's trying to do. He's trying to not look behind, and he's not trying to look ahead either.
I heard that about him, too. Somebody said, I don't know who said it, if it was you, or somebody else told me that he is very...
ChabDog was pointing at me.
Yeah. Somebody said he's very aware of the fact he doesn't want to think about himself, so he doesn't want to even think about how many points he has,
right,
what kind of game he's really having. He just wants to focus in the moment.
Good. Right. That's
a good philosophy.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
very
where
sound.
Yeah, and that's what he was exactly talking about, was playing today, you know, playing in the moment and playing today's game and not looking behind and not looking ahead, just focusing on today's game.
He can't be the only player on the court subscribing to this kind of philosophy, his outlook, can he?
I think a lot of people play because usually for a lot of the season, you're thinking about your statistics and how well you're doing and your contract value.
Yes.
Naturally, because people just tend to think about themselves. It's just like on a baseball team.
Well, if it's a business, you're 100% right. Yeah, you're going to have this all spreadsheeted out. You're going to be looking at those numbers. You're going to be updating those numbers. You're going to be massaging those numbers. You're going to be very well aware of the metrics. If you're a player, it's different. You're 100% right. Yeah, you're thinking, yeah, you just make the shot. Get yourself in position.
All I know is that I played Little League, when I was having a bad day.
It's a lot like Little League.
I was playing Little League and I had a bad day, I wasn't real happy, even if I was happy the team was winning, but you always were thinking about what you're batting. I mean, that you can't get around that because you know you've come up four times and gotten two hits or one hit.
Well,
and
I guess that's the difference between Little League and a pro.
Yeah, that's not
pro forgets.
That's not helping you in the moment.
No, it's not at all.
And that's why he recovers so fast. You know, he doesn't get down on himself. He's always there trying, even though he missed those foul shots. Doesn't matter.
That sounds a lot like a bedroom experience now. You can get it off.
I mean, that's what life is. You're constantly trying to block out negativity so you can get
it's blocking out negativity. It's keeping your mind focused on ideas that are leading you to positive places instead of ones that, either are neutral or, you know, take you to bad memories or bad experiences or bad outcomes. Sure.
But sometimes negativity, you can use that in the right way, you know, like George Costanza and what he did in that clip where he...
Well, it comes from recognizing that you've got recognizing that the outcomes, what you've been doing has been leading you into bad outcomes and sometimes maybe the opposite of what you wanted along.
I want to hear this again.
And fading it. Because every time I see this, I think of Tank, and not that Tank makes bad choices.
He does in one way
and one way only when he's picking sports teams.
He did pick the Suns.
Yeah, he did pick the Suns. Really, and
that was a red flag.
And if you roll the tape back when he did, I damned him for doing that because he screwed
him. It's kind of like the Sports Illustrated jinx.
But check this out. This classic.
Where were you?
Mashup here.
I went to the beach.
Oh, the beach.
My back.
Stop working, Jerry. Just stop working.
What is it that isn't working?
Why did it all turn out like this for me? I had so much promise. I was personable. I was bright. Oh, maybe not academically speaking, but I was perceptive. I always know when someone's uncomfortable at a party.
That happened over there?
It all became very clear to me sitting out there today that every decision I've ever made in my entire life has been wrong.
Yes.
My life is the complete opposite of everything I want it to be.
That's it right
every
there.
Every instinct I have in every aspect of life, be it something to wear, something to eat, it's often wrong.
It's not what you want.
Tuna on toast, coleslaw, cup of coffee.
Yeah. No, wait a minute. I always have tuna on toast.
Look at this.
Nothing's ever worked out for me with tuna on toast. I want the complete opposite of tuna on toast. Chicken salad on rye. Untoasted.
How is that the opposite?
I know. Why is that the opposite?
At least you try it.
I'm trying to figure that out.
And a cup of tea.
I think what
well,
it is
there's
is
no
it,
telling what can happen.
It's a weird combination. Really.
You know, chicken salad's not the opposite of tuna. Salmon's the opposite of tuna because salmon swim against
put
the current.
Chicken salad
and the tuna
online.
Swim with.
Well, I would at a belly, I would definitely eat that.
Good for the tuna.
Willingly.
Put bacon.
I think it actually is
the opposite.
But the potato salad doesn't go with the chicken salad that well.
Here comes the money shot.
So what? What am I supposed to do?
Go talk to her.
Elaine, bald men with no jobs and no money who live with their parents don't approach strange women.
Well, here's your chance to try the opposite. Instead of tuna salad and being intimidated by women, chicken salad and going right up to them.
Yeah, I should do the opposite. I should.
If every instinct you have is wrong, then the opposite would have to be right.
Yeah. That's how we make money with that.
It goes against every instinct that he
yes.
has.
I will do the opposite. I used to sit here and do nothing and regret it for the rest of the day. So now I will do the opposite and I will do something.
Yes. Yes. You got to realize
he's
it.
He's getting up and going for it.
Look at that. You know, butterflies in his stomach right now.
Excuse me. I couldn't help but notice that. You were looking in my direction.
Oh, yes, I was. You just ordered the same exact lunch as me.
My name is George. I'm unemployed and I live with my parents.
See? He decided not
I'm
to hide
Victoria,
that.
Hi. What are we going to do? Should we just move?
It won't be necessary.
Shut your traps and stop kicking the seats! We're trying to watch the movie! And if I have to tell you again, we're gonna take it outside and I'm gonna show you what it's like! You understand me?
Shut your mouths or I'll shut them for you. And if you think I'm kidding, just try me. Try me.
Try me.
Because I would love
try
it!
Try me, punk.
Yes, everybody wants to do that.
I just found $20! I tell you this, something is happening in my life. I did this opposite thing last night. Up was down, black was white, good was
bad,
day was
night.
Yes!
So you just did the opposite of everything?
Yes! And listen to this, listen to this. Our uncle works for the Yankees and is going to get me a job interview. A front office kind of thing. Assistant to the traveling secretary. A job with the New York Yankees. This has been the dream of my life ever since I was a child. And it's all happening because I'm completely ignoring every urge towards common sense and good judgment I've ever had. This is no longer just some crazy notion. Elaine, Jerry, this is my religion.
Babe, yourself.
Well, I guess your messiah would be the Antichrist.
Or the anti-queen pole.
You are the complete opposite of every applicant we've seen.
Mr. Steinbrenner, sir. There's someone here I'd like you to meet.
I love that.
This is
Mr.
Costanza.
That's
Mr. He's
Beaks.
One of the applicants. Yes.
Nice to meet you.
Well, I wish I could say the same, but I must say, with all due respect, I find it very hard to see the logic behind some of the moves you have made with this fine organization. In the past 20 years, you have caused myself and the city of New York a good deal of distress as we have watched you take our beloved Yankees and reduce them to a laughingstock, all for the glorification of your massive ego.
Hire this man.
Classic. Abe likes it.
That's awesome.
Hire him. Yeah, that's something you see. That's something you can see Steinbrenner doing too in a similar situation. It's
that's
classic.
Hilarious.
It's great.
That's fade yourself.
Fade yourself.
Fade yourself. You know what? That's I'm gonna learn that. Fade. I'm gonna fade myself. Yeah. There's only when
well,
I met.
Knowing when to do it is the key.
When I met Tank, that's when this really became apparent.
Yes. Oh yeah, well, and profitable at times as well.
He can't help himself. He's always going to say what he wants to say and do what he wants to do.
Oh, and he has his hunches. He's gonna pick based on his hunches and his calculations and whatever satisfies him to utter that answer. And it's often for disastrous results.
I do feel like that a lot of times in football season when some you have a bad week and like everything goes the way that you didn't think it was going to go.
Mm-hmm.
You think about doing the George and fading yourself.
Well, I can't wait for that to happen. When's that occurring?
But right now.
A month away, we get, we'll be in the thick of, oh no, yeah, no, we'll be in the towards the end of preseason. Won't that be great?
Yeah. Preseason. I know you look forward to that. We'll be
at the beginning of preseason. I'll be around the 15th. That's
Preseason football, I find as interesting as the NFL draft.
We'll be in our new studios as well.
Yeah. That's going to be after when in August? The second week or the third week?
Well, after the 15th. So I don't know where the next Sunday is after that, but that's going to be pretty exciting.
I
want to
come down for the grand opening.
Yeah, grand opening of our new studios in Newport Beach.
Well, and
although I'm so happy that we've got in today's studios, we've got some. You know, we've got new technology today. We have a new camera person has joined the team.
We're completely connected.
Dacey has joined the team as a camera. We'd say cameraman back in the day, but camera person, camera operator, camera technician.
Bingo in the background.
Yes, we just need Bingo here live.
Next week, I could bring the dog. By the way,
so let's wave to the cameras, everybody. Hello, world. And want to also thank
yes.
Abe Miranda for this wonderful gift, which mm-hmm. is a three-tin set of Tabasco seasoning. And these are like rubs and such.
It's
going to
make
your
meat that much better.
Exactly. You got barbecue, you got all-purpose. There's even one for fish. So.
There's even one for fish?
Yeah, you can rub some on your meat. I'm going to put some on some fish.
I don't eat a lot of fish. Once in a while.
That's the joke.
Yesterday I did. I went to a Japanese restaurant.
Oh, what did
That's probably why I've got the Buck Owens song in my head.
What, because the Japanese restaurant?
Yeah, because I was in that restaurant, and yeah, there were some geisha-looking girls there. And
Do you have worms?
It was kind of a turn-on. I liked my ramen soup.
A turn-on? Turn-on?
But if this song had been played in the background, that Buck Owens song, I probably would have eaten twice as much. It's very mesmerizing.
It really is mesmerizing. It's not that long. And, you know, let's turn it on. It'll be fun to,
I'm not gonna
to go on that ride on this vibe for the rest of the show.
Every instinct was telling me save this for the end. Yeah. But I went against it. Saving myself.
There you go.
I gave in. So now you're going to hear it.
It's an example of the power.
I forgot about that.
I only know him from Beehive.
Okay. I think at some point you were asking Clark's story. And when it's night over here, over there, it wasn't as good.
Well, he's doing shows, I guess, and dancing and stuff like that. And going to the nightclub rug. Times I had a walking in the sand. Yeah. With the beautiful
girl that I met made in Japan. We should also play the The beauty of her face was
beyond my wildest dreams. Oh yeah, we'll play that. Yeah. That's on Yeehaw. Like cherry blossoms blooming in the mountain in the early spring.
As we walked by the river and she softly took hold of my hand. Well, I'm looking forward to the Olympics in Japan. That's when I fell deep
in love with the girl made in Japan. Oh, this infection and COVID talk and crap going on.
Yeah,
put their own medals around their neck and crap. I don't
know. No? No, I'm gonna check it out. I like tracking skills.
In the dark of night, we would lay on Tokyo.
I like the wrestling. That's amazing. I love the wrestling. And the singing of the birds will be something. You don't see that as much, though. They don't show it as much. Her smiling eyes always seem to try to understand all the love in my heart for the girl made in Japan. I would watch her. She said she'd been promised to another
man. I love you, baby.
That's when I left my heart with the girl made in Japan. Yeah.
Yes, my heart will always be with the girl made
in Japan. So, good Japanese food.
It's a great song.
Yes. puts me real, warmed my heart to hear
right now
that.
It just burns up a whole segment that we had planned for, or how we'll have to find something else to close the show with, but all right.
Oh, well, went ever against every instinct of mine.
I know, that's, yeah, exactly. So it's obviously...
So you might be a little, it might be a little unsettling today.
It might lead to a good place, but normally when you follow your instincts, we usually get to good places, so this might...
that's the sub-theme of the show.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I did see that, well, we're at prepared a very nice lineup of music, so... I'm sure we'll find something here that's really beachy at the end of the show.
That
we got that.
Speaking of which, we've got clips today.
This will be appropriate.
Yes, when we do, we've got that lined up. But we've also got clips from what was that? Austin Powers.
Austin Powers.
That was funny. You want to talk about stereotyping Japanese? But here we go. Maltese Falcon. I insist we play this over the break. It's a classic clip with the fat man, Sidney Greenstreet, speaking with Humphrey Bogart about the statue itself. I'm not sure we're going to play the gun shower this scene there, but we Rockford Files answering machine, little Hill Street Blues oral exam, literally, which I guess won't surprise you. L.A. Law. Yeah, might play L.A. Law as a tribute to ChabDog choosing his law career and going to UCLA. And being a Hollywood lawyer.
Never got to work with Susan Day, though.
No. Well, that's okay. I mean, Partridge Family. And yeah.
Laurie, right?
Laurie? Yes. Boy, you're a savant sometimes. That's it. And then speaking Laurie of savants, we're going to play this Tourette scene here because I think it's cool to see how they perceived it back in 19... You know, today, what are rights guaranteed under the Americans with Disabilities Act? This guy probably wouldn't even be in court. But in 1989, without those protections, here he is just trying to defend his utterings that he has through no fault of his own. And people, you know, being offended by it, but speaking about offense. Yeah, look at the wart in that lady's face right there.
So that rat would be gnawing at that for a long time.
Uncle Buck's going to go to town on her. And then there's the Buck Owens, Jerry Reed scene.
Yeah, that was really classic.
That's going to be great. And then, them's fun. We're not playing this part of it. We're going to talk about Tom Brady.
Yeah, this was a classic.
But,
do you know they're going to the White House this next week?
Good for them.
See Biden.
Yeah. Let's see Biden. Okay.
Yeah, Tom Brady will be very polite.
Brady would rather have seen Brady like Trump better, but okay.
I know.
And then here's some, we got some Buckwheat clips going here too.
Oh, yeah.
Since it is the Buckwheat, so we get to basketball talk, we'll play that. And of course, Speed Racer's coming up in 8 minutes. So that's the lineup for the show today, guys.
It's still jam-packed.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sorry I didn't bring any buckwheat pancakes for everybody, but...
Oh, it's okay.
They don't sell those at McDonald's. Have you ever had buckwheat?
Of course. I've made them myself, but I've never bought them at McDonald's.
It's a different taste. It's a hard... For me, it's kind of a hard taste to even describe. I don't... Actually...
Yeah, so you won't bother, right?
I would eat buckwheat pancakes, but I'd rather have regular pancakes.
You'd rather have regular? Yeah, I'd rather have regular, too.
Buckwheat's a little bit kind of...
Eat buckwheat when you can get nothing else.
Sterner. It's crap. Like there's something.
It's just shit. I don't know. Eat pancakes at all.
It's not sweet enough.
It's supposed to be healthy.
Yeah.
It's not. It's just. Ugh. Speaking of healthy, though.
That healthy goes against every.
Well, we're watching the Yankees. You may not have been familiar with what happened to the Mets, and we will get to the Mets. We'll get to the Mets. But what about the Yankees Red Sox game?
What happened? Because I know the Red Sox won the first Verdugo game, right? Didn't he?
Yeah, so it was raining and stuff. And you know your boy Alex Verdugo?
He's having a good year, by the way.
Yeah, well, a fan hit him square in the back with a baseball thrown from the stands.
What? No.
Yeah.
The fan, did he hurt him?
Well, who knows? I mean, of course they're all going to say they
were
hurt.
Was it a home run or a double that just got thrown back into the...
The source of the ball was not recorded, but it was... He was hit, and then Verdugo then turned around, and all the fans started flipping him off and going, ah, fuck you, Verdugo, fuck you. And so they were having trouble finding the person who did it, and then Cora, started crying.
Oh, come on, this is...
Like a crybaby.
This is much ado about... Oh, so it was a Yankees guy. Fan.
Oh, yeah, they were playing in Yankees.
Oh,
games.
Well, then I can understand
Cora,
that.
I wouldn't
put anything past a Yankees
and
fan.
So I think they walked off for... The game was disrupted for a while until
Yankees,
that cleared up.
So... Now they're resorting to that because they can't beat us.
Well, the fans are.
Was it in left field?
They can't handle it, man.
Left field?
Yes.
Was that in left field?
Yeah,
this
it was
the Red
field.
Sox tide has risen.
Do you know who did it?
No, well, I'm not saying I know exactly who did it, but I mean, traditionally at Yankee Stadium, your famous, infamous bleacher.
Yeah, the bleacher rats.
We call them what, bleacher creatures?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Over there. I mean, they're usually on right field. But when Frank and I went to the Yankees game, you know, it felt like there were some bleacher creatures over on left field as well. So it seems like, you know, it just seems like you can't really get away from it on right or left field.
Mm-hmm.
But roll call, which is what, you know, where everybody starts chanting and doing all sorts of crazy stuff, that's still predominantly on the right field.
Uh-huh.
But I'm not that surprised that it came from left field, because, like I said, mm-hmm. when Frank and I were there, it just seemed like it was...
Yeah, it was left side.
It was left, right. We were sitting in left field near the bullpen,
uh-huh.
The visitor's bullpen, but even there, it felt like there was some heckling and some things going on. There were a couple times a security officer had to tell a few Yankees fans to settle down. Yeah. I'm not too surprised.
It makes sense because, of course, it came out of left field. That's the expression.
Oh, it's
the
expression.
It came out of left field.
Yeah.
So why is that expression like that? There must be something about left
ballparks,
field.
Ballparks, yeah, it's the cheap seats they sell in left field.
Wild and unpredictable things happen in left field.
Well, people get drinking beer all day.
Yeah, surprisingly, someone
otherwise
throws
it
baseballs.
Would have been, it comes out of the outfield.
Yeah.
Okay.
So Verdugo got beamed, and they were all, you know, whining about it, and it did come out of left field there. And now, which side throws more batteries, left or right? Battery chuckers are left field, aren't they?
I guess so.
Yeah.
It's hard.
To be, people would sneak in and with 9 volts and D batteries and stuff, and they'd, like, be throwing those at the players. That's
yeah.
Oh, this has been going on for years. Yeah, it's like back in the 80s. 70s and 80s, they'd be chucking.
The thing about right field is it's the short porch. Right,
yeah.
You know, that's. I mean, at least at Dodger Stadium, the bleachers. I mean, the only thing they're guilty of is starting the wave. Yeah. That's about it over down there.
It's the opposite.
Yeah, it's pretty kind of chill over at Dodger Stadium. You don't usually see people throwing baseballs at them.
So the Yankees ended up winning that game. It was a rain shortened game.
Oh.
And then something weird happened in Washington last night.
I know, there was a shooting.
There was a shooting at the Nats Padres game.
The Nats had a problem there.
And so they had to, they halted the game. They're going to be resuming it today, and they'll finish it up.
You had to,
it's pretty halted. Serious. Yeah, they had to empty the stadium.
No, there was 2 cars in the area were shooting at each other. Or people in, I mean, I guess cars don't shoot, but occupants in them with guns were shooting
I
at each other.
I just wonder why they had to. Like, I guess it was situation lasted for a while. Like, why did
they said everyone's stadium was locked down and just long enough that they, I don't know. I'd be guessing they were saying, well, let's assess the situation. Where are the bullets? How many are there? Is it safe? Is it not? And I guess it takes them 2 hours to do it. Who knows? It's 3 hours, whatever.
Well,
conduct an investigation, which is fine.
News.
Well, it is.
Anytime anybody's
heard. Do you
remember
a baseball game getting disrupted by gunfire?
I can't really remember.
No.
It's probably happened, but...
So if we start suppressing this, you know, because we, you know, like I got eyes. You know, America's more violent today than it was 3 years ago. Sorry. There's just more violent gun violence and violent crime going on. So if we want to suppress this crime, would this be suppressing the rights of gun owners? So would the right wing be also against this kind of suppression, this kind of curtailing this kind of crime? Because we clearly, you know, I know years before our policing was a match for this.
What's your question?
Well, I'll phrase it this way. The policing we've had before. Hey. The policing we've had before was more than up to the task to take care of this kind of, you know, petty thug gun stuff and get these guys behind bars. And the justice system was more than a match to lock them away so they wouldn't be out making all this problem. And now it's not. And so the point is, are we giving these people the rights to do this, you know, because we don't want to infringe on their gun rights, like the right wing, or are we doing this because we don't want to incarcerate these people, because somehow incarcerating them is not fair to them?
I don't know, we've had violence in our
society. Like, why are we doing this? Because it's like, otherwise,
why, you know, we have violence.
Baseball games shouldn't be getting disrupted by gunfire. That's bullshit.
It's possible.
No, well, it happened. But that
but
shouldn't
it's not
be.
That's
gonna
change any gun laws, I don't think.
Well, he's being a little facetious there, actually.
I don't even know what who was involved.
Right wing's into it
there
at
was
all.
There was a gun involved, but I don't know.
Well, what somebody
kind
shot
of gun,
a gun. At somebody.
What kind of gun it
well,
was?
I have no idea. Nobody does.
Was it an assault rifle? Or was it just like a normal?
It's big enough to disrupt the game, anyway.
Yeah. Well, that's.
I know. I'm. I just like to see. Hey, come down. You know, our leaders. Will you please grow a spine and start getting tough on crime? Like that's the point. But I mean, I don't know, maybe you disagree.
Tough on
maybe
crime. That was a pretty hard case to make a year ago, with all the people saying the police were being there were too many police and all the defund the police thing.
I know.
So I don't think that we're going to swing the other way anytime soon.
Swing.
But maybe if people say what they the opposite of what they.
There we go. Yeah.
Don't follow your instincts and it might work out.
Stop following your instincts to want to be kind and compassionate and let all these criminals out of jail because, you know, like our like George Gascon and such and not put them there in the first place thinking that that's somehow going to improve things. And look, it would be great if that happened and crime didn't go up. I'd be all for it. All for it. I don't want people in jail any more than they want to be there. I'm not cruel or inhumane, but it's back to, but if we do the opposite. If we do the opposite and put them in jail, maybe we'll get the outcome we're seeking, just like George. Anyway.
The opposite is often what you really want.
This is a great segue. Let's get out of this segment. Let's get out of it fast. It's half past the hour. We promise you.
We've got to be punctual.
Here he comes. Here comes the racer. He's a demon on wheels. He's a demon and he's gonna be chasing after someone. He's gaining on you, so you better look alive. He's busy revving up the powerful Mach 5. And when the odds are against him and there's dangerous work to do, you bet your life's the racer. See it through. Ghost Speed Racer. He's often flying as he guns a car around the track. He's jamming down the pedal like he's never coming back. Adventures waiting just ahead. Ghost Speed Racer, go!
Man, he is a fly boy.
Yeah.
I like Speed Racer. He looks cool. He looks cool, and I just that song always
couldn't
reminds
be
me of California. You
could
know,
well, and just hearing that just puts me in such a good mood. You know, it's just such a even if you didn't grow up with it, it's just a great song to hear. But right now, I want to introduce the host of ChabDog Racing.
Do you know Miranda?
Do you even know the Miranda rights?
First, I have to read you the Miranda rights. You have the right to remain
Abe Miranda.
I've never Miranda'd anyone before. Yeah.
Don't give me attitudes.
It's time to be Miranda'd.
Oh man, I love that, and it's funny because Lenny Dystra follows me on Twitter because of my Miranda rights. Essentially, what happened was he got arrested, and like literally the next day, I tweeted something to him, and he found it so funny that like somebody named Miranda after being read his Miranda rights that. Yeah. It was like, next thing you know, I had Lenny following me on Twitter. Really? So, yeah.
You and Nails?
Yeah.
Are we close?
I'm not going to say we're close, but we're at least Twitter friends. That's interesting.
Well, that's one guy we'd like to talk to.
I know, right? I have to ask him. Hey,
well,
man,
Tank has had him on. Tank's interviewed him a number of times.
Yeah, so.
Oh, man.
He grants Tank an interview whenever he wants, so.
So, you know, it's just funny because that's Miranda Wright seems to follow me around even on Twitter. So here we go. All right. So I'd like to just kind of go back to talking a little bit about last week's race. And that one was, of course, our Atlanta Motor Speedway. That was the Quaker State 400 presented by Walmart. Our top three finish race leaders here was Kurt Busch. He took the trophy, followed by Kyle Busch and Martin Truex Jr. So there's, of course, it was interesting to see the Busch brothers win the race, 1-2.
Who's the younger Busch?
I think it's Kyle. I think Kyle's the younger Busch.
So Kurt's the older son, and he... Because he's not as successful as Kyle, right?
Well, I mean, they're both successful in their own way, but I think Kyle has taken the podium a little bit more than his brother.
That's pretty impressive for brothers to finish 1-2 like that.
Yeah, it is. It's actually, I mean, I would think so. I mean, I think if Tank and I came 1-2 on something, that would be cool too.
It might be the best brother tandem in his brother duo in history, besides the other ones that I remember are the Sedins, right?
Yeah.
In hockey.
Yeah.
The Sedin brothers.
Yeah, you know. Well, also they got the Mannings too. Peyton, Eli Manning.
Oh, those two.
That's another
brother
duo.
That's probably.
Those are really good. That's a good duo right there. Sisters, you got the Williams sisters.
Yeah, yeah.
You got the Williams sisters.
And you know what you also have? You have Ozzy and Jose Canseco.
Okay. Rat. You know, it's funny.
What did Ozzy ever do?
I don't know, man. What did Jose Canseco
do?
He's just
got a good name.
The whole thing is funny, man. I love the fact that they have Barstool has made him a rat bastard. That's hilarious. You know, Frank and I, we went miniature golfing.
Yeah, of course, the other ones are the Alus.
Oh, yeah.
You there were three of them.
It's just, like I said.
Sorry, I keep going, but.
Yeah.
there was three Sherrys, Norm, Larry, and. No, there's just two Sherrys, Norm and Larry.
Lots of siblings out there. You know, lots of
Go
siblings.
Go ahead, keep going. We took a detour.
We took a massive detour on the racing segment here. But, anyways, that's how we're doing. At least not last week, we had. Decided we picked a few drivers for a checkered flag. Of course, the wacky hot mess came in. She came in 12th place, but better than the entire ChabDog sports team with Austin Dillon.
Yeah. She beat us.
So she beat
us. We've never heard of before driving the number 13 car.
Austin Powers.
I don't know if he was driving the 13
Austin Powers
car,
or something.
But he was in the 13th spot.
Cue
he
Austin
started,
Powers.
He
Cue
started
Austin
on the 13th spot there. And he finished 12th, so, and he ended up beating both of us because Kyle Larson came in 18th place and Joey Logano came in 19th place. So, wacky hot mess coming
by,
into the
By the way,
today.
Where is she?
She's actually doing her weights a moment ago. She's doing her weightlifting
routine.
So
is she going to grace us with her presence, or is she just not going to be here today?
I have no idea. You know, I cannot tell you what a woman's going to do.
You must have told her that
do,
I was
going to... Do you know what women are going to do? I mean, do you think I know what women are going to do?
Did you tell her that I was going to play that Tom Brady clip?
No, I didn't want to catch SHIT this early in the morning. I'm sorry.
Shows up.
Yeah, no, I already erased it, dude. You know, it's not getting played. That's bad luck.
At some point, you guys are going to have to face facts. And
well, when we beat Tom Brady in the Super Bowl this year, we'll have faced it. Okay, this is Chiefs household, brother.
You gotta open your eyes to reality, and the reality is it's a Tom Brady world.
Okay, well, speaking of Tom Brady, you know he did.
So anyway, go back to
let's go back to racing. We'll talk about Tom Brady later.
I love you guys.
Tom
you guys
Brady.
Are awesome.
Hold on, I got to play with you since we mentioned Tom Brady.
Fucking douche.
All right, move on.
Yeah. It goes. I love it. You know, I love my racing segment. It's all over the place.
Completely like this. It took you getting married to a Chiefs fan before you this Brady stuff.
Became. What Brady stuff?
That you don't like him.
Who, Brady?
Yeah.
Fucking douche.
You didn't hate him before.
No, I didn't. I don't really hate him now, but that doesn't, you know, I also see him for what he is.
Fucking douche.
I like him really I like him in Florida a little bit better. I like Florida Brady a little bit better than New England Brady.
I guess I do too.
You know, I think it's
even when he was
fucking douche.
You know, I always respected him because the guy is a killer.
I respected him until he went to Florida. That was a, you know what kind of move that is? That's a
fucking douche
move.
That's a LeBron James move.
Remember when LeBron had the hats? Remember when LeBron had the hats?
Remember he had the whole show about the choice? Yeah, you know what, LeBron? You are a
fucking douche.
Yeah, you and Tom Brady are both.
There's so much bitterness.
Fucking douche.
Is.
I touched a raw nerve. Let's go back to your show.
Okay, back to racing, please.
I'm sorry, everybody.
But speaking of, who is the winner?
I do want to be reminded of my Austin pick, though.
Yeah.
Can you play this?
No, it was Wacky Hot Mess. It took Austin and won, wasn't it?
No, I was the one Didn't I pick Austin something?
You picked Joey Logano?
You picked Joey Logano. So yeah, we picked Joey Logano.
Okay, so somebody else picked
Wacky Hot Mess. Wacky Hot Mess. She won with and this is how Wacky this is.
It's Austin Powers! He's so funny.
Yeah, you know.
Awesome. Very sexy fun. Can I have autograph?
Of course. Your name is?
Fuck me.
Oh, behave, baby. Yes. Now, your name is?
Fuck me.
You kiss your mother with that mouth?
Fuck me. Like this.
Oh, I see. Your name is Fuck me.
You want a drink?
Yes, of course. But you know, I have a private bar in the back that you're more than welcome to use.
Here you go.
But
sexy.
Fuck me, that was fast.
Fuck you.
Oh, you're going the right way for a smack bottom, and I don't care who knows it.
Austin. This is my twin sister. Her name, Fuck you. Fuck you. Fuck me. See?
They blurred her panties.
Twins.
Oh, because it's Japanese, right?
Twins, yes.
I've never watched Japanese porn.
We're going to see the twins.
I also think Austin Powers is very sexy for you. I think you're very great, baby. Do we make you sleepy?
Well, you make me many things, but sleepy's not one of them.
We give you top secret at the massage. Yes, top secret at the massage, baby.
Uh-oh.
I'm sorry about that. I swear to God, that never happens. Yes, hold on a tick. Okay.
Travel through time backward and forward.
Okay, now where were we, babies? Yes.
To each his own, right?
Clever. So clever.
Austin, I'm sorry to interrupt.
Twin What's his name?
Oh, Michael
Twin
York.
Michael York. Thank you.
Michael
it's
York
your
makes
father.
An appearance.
Yes.
Bye-bye.
What?
Bye.
He's been kidnapped.
Is that what he looks like?
Well, he doesn't know. He doesn't look that good now.
Yeah, he looked pretty good there.
Pretty good.
Like,
all
he
right.
filled out.
We just, like, are taking over.
Because Michael York was always kind of a thin guy, okay, well, you know.
That's great. Quit taking over Abe's segment.
I know.
Okay. Let's get back to racing.
I forgot. Thank you.
Yeah.
And we're back.
Yeah, what else is going on?
So we're going to talk a little bit about today's race. Today's race is actually going to be the Fox Woods Resort Casino 301 race.
Fox Woods.
Fox Woods.
Yeah, yeah. The Fox Woods is that, Resort a, Casino. It's a casino.
Rhode Island? Is that the huge one? Is that the one in Rhode Island that Mark used to go to?
This is going to be the Fox one Woods? In New Fox Hampshire. Wood.
Yeah, Foxwoods is New England.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's New Hampshire.
That's a big one there. Okay.
So today's race is going to be at 12 p.m. ChabDog Newport Beach time and 3 p.m. Eastern. It's going to be broadcast on NBC Sports Network, PRN Radio, and will be streaming also on NBC Sports. So you'll be able to... Mm. access that via the online channels.
Who's supposed to win that one?
Well, I mean, I can only tell you who's on the lineup right now.
Yeah.
And for that one, it's Kyle Busch is up front, followed by Martin Truex Jr. and Chase Elliott. So those are your top three for your
Joe Gibbs
Woods.
Racing
that
team.
Sounds like one where they didn't qualify. They just got ranked based on their statistics. Or
they're
something.
Just getting ranked up there. It didn't look like they're actually doing any type of qualifying.
Yeah,
because
that's
like
if I had to think of the three guys that are...
One, they do it.
The three they have the best records this year.
Yeah, it's some sort of interesting formula there. So, of course, this one is at located at the New Hampshire Motor Speedway. And it's located in Lunden, New Hampshire, which is interesting because our F1 race today was in Great Britain as well. And, of course, they've began, actually, this is a one-mile track. So it's just a little bit over a mile. It's an oval-type track, and they've been hosting NASCAR races at this facility since 1993. It is asphalt and granite, and that's the makeup of the track.
Good traction surfaces.
Of course, this will be three stages. It's going to be 301 laps for a total of about 318.5 miles today.
11.
Of course, the first, like I mentioned before, the first race was in 1993, and Rusty Wallace was the first winner of that race.
First winner.
So we're talking about going back a little bit.
Rusty Wallace. That's a name from the past.
Holy dog shit!
Of course, when we talk about which driver has the most wins at this speedway, just adding them up, Jeff Burton and Kevin Harvick hold the most victories here with 4. So both of them have won 4 races at here in New Hampshire. And so that's a little bit about what's going to happen for today's race. And as always, we always like to pick some sort of checkered flag for today. So if any of you have a specific pick with Kyle Busch, any of the Busch brothers, Martin Truex Jr., Chase Elliott, Alex Bowman, Denny Hamlin, Ryan Blaney, Tyler Reddick, Christopher Bell, and Kyle Larson. These are your top 10 that are up on the lineup today. Of course, I have a good feeling about Chase Elliott or Martin Truex Jr. today. But do you guys have any special picks?
Well, I can go.
All right.
You get to go first.
In the spirit of this show, I've got absolutely no reason to pick every reason to pick Kurt Busch because, he almost won last week.
Yeah, please do it.
He's had a great year, and there's really no reason why he can't just continue it in this race.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to go against every good instinct of mine and pick Kyle Larson.
Oh.
Who's really kind of slowed down lately, and, I wouldn't think he'd just turn things around this week, but why not?
I like that little psych move, man. We think we were going with Kurt Busch, and then pulls a Seinfeld on my ass.
Yeah.
And next thing you know, he's like Kyle Larson from the back pocket, baby. Uh-huh. Good for you, man.
Learning from George.
I like that.
What did you learn? What do you think?
Well, I use my rational sense, which often works well, too, by the way. And I'm picking Martin Truex Jr. from the Joe Gibbs Racing Team. And I know he's the number 2 car, and he's going to finish the race the number 1 car.
That's a good pick, as always. Get a little Martin Truex Jr. in there.
Yeah.
From Joe Gibbs Racing.
I don't pick him enough.
Roots back to the Washington Redskins, right?
You're not allowed to say Redskins, though.
I'm not allowed to say a lot of things, but we say it anyway.
My son, by the way, is picking Redskins all the time in Madden.
Yes.
And it was kind of working for a small time against me until I picked the Broncos, and I went with Peyton Manning. And
what year Redskins is he using?
2015.
Oh, well. Yeah. So the team's going to do nothing. He's got to get 1980.
We did trounce him yesterday.
Get Theismann as quarterback and come back. Rippon.
There were some great moments, man.
Can you get Rippon as quarterback? Can you take a historical team and play your
Well, that would be a great product, wouldn't it? Mm-hmm. If you could design your own team from the list of people, they could have a database and you just pick the players and make up your own team.
I haven't played Madden in years.
I don't know if you can do that or not.
I bet you can.
It's probably too much work for me to find out.
Well, yeah, there you go.
So I'm gonna.
Who are you taking, Abe?
Well, you know what? I'm looking at Alex Bowman. This is kind of
okay. My gut feeling is actually more twinged on that guy. But what's a gut feeling for?
So I'm gonna. You know what?
He won a race.
I'm gonna pull the trigger on Alex Bowman.
Alex Bowman. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we're gonna go with Alex. He came kind of. He was up there last week. He was up in the. He was like number 4.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not bad because we had Martin Truex Jr. was in 3rd place. And then we had the Busch brothers up there at front. So, with that strategy here, I'm thinking
you know, not too bad picks with Martin Truex Jr. and Alex Bowman. Of course, you went with the Seinfeld pick and just went with Kyle Larson, even though your gut was telling you Kurt Busch.
Common sense would have told him Busch.
I like that.
He's intrigued.
I like that. That's like a, you know, reminds me of junior high when the girl said she would go to the dance with me, and then all of a sudden I show up to the dance. She wasn't there.
That happened to you?
No, well, yeah, kind of, but my mom, I'm sorry. No, it gets better. I didn't tell my mom I was going to the dance, so my mom came to the school, and then she got on the DJ floor, and the DJ's like, "Hey, is Abe Miranda here?" And I was so excited because I was at a dance, and the DJ was calling me out, and I was like, "I'm here, I'm here, I'm here."
Oh, my God, so your mom was...
And the DJ's like, "Oh, your mom's here." And I was like, oh!
So all the kids knew your mom was there?
Oh, yeah. Everybody
did anyone break out in laughter?
You know what?
Was there applause?
I have some interesting junior high school.
That's not as bad, though. That's not as bad as what happened to my friend, because when I was kids, all of us played on the street together, you know. So one time we were playing, and the kid's mom opens the door and said, "Mikey, it's time to come home to watch Batman."
I'm glad it was.
That kid was so embarrassed.
He's like, "Yes, mommy."
It wasn't really cool at a certain age to watch Batman.
He's like, "All right, guys, I'll catch you at the professor's class tomorrow." I gotta go watch.
That was like total public shaming. Yours was only partial.
Yeah, mine was kind of partial, but it was funny. But I liked the twist. I grew up enjoying plot twists. And ChabDog perfectly executed one in the racing segment. So that's how we're looking for today's race. We've got...
And then Formula One, did you talk about that?
Well, I'm about to jump into today's race. So today's race...
happening right now.
Which actually concluded, but was our Great Britain 2021 race.
Not just Britain, it's great.
It was Great Britain.
And not Good Britain.
And of course, you know, the British folks will be very, very happy knowing that Lewis Hamilton came in first place today.
I'm a friend of Sarah.
Followed by...
He's a Brit. Is that right?
Correct. Sounds very British. He's from England. So, and then...
That's actually kind of weird that a Brit won in Britain.
Yeah.
And of course...
It doesn't happen.
We had Charles...
Didn't see that coming.
Except for, since Virginia Wade.
Virgin?
Virginia Wade.
Virginia Wade.
She was a British women's tennis player who won Wimbledon.
Mm. Okay.
And this is, of course, this is not in London, Great Britain, like today's NASCAR race in London, New Hampshire. Mm. But it's in Silverstone, Great Britain. I'm not exactly sure where Silverstone is, but
sure. That's a nice name for a racing.
But race. I can tell you
or a fry pan.
That over 300,000 people came to that race today.
Oh, wow.
It was packed.
They like that in Britain, don't they?
Oh, man. I mean, you know, the thing is like Europeans, man.
Why
whatever
that?
Sport you give them, they just go bananas for. And, you know, like, of course, you know, football, they go like, nuts.
Except the American League of American, the European
gotta,
League American
they
football.
Tap
that way.
Into that somehow.
But, you know, I do see, and you know, and I do see. I know that they're big fans of the NBA. I have a lot of friends and family from Europe. They love the NBA. And Formula One just, you know, Formula One is I think what it is, too, is that, you know, they race in different countries all the time. And so when they're in England, you know, there isn't a lot of races, Formula One races in England. And so when they're there at home,
so they're starved for it.
It's like oh my gosh, everybody shows up because it's like it's that big race. Just like here in the U.S., you know, we all get excited when they come to COTA in Texas. I mean, it's like everybody shows up for that because that's the one race that we have in the United States, you know. And so people just come out in huge turnouts. But it was over 300,000 people that showed up to today's race. I can tell you that the biggest highlight actually came in the first lap where Max Verstappen, who was, you know, your pole position leader.
Verstappen.
Yeah, Verstappen.
Verstappen. No,
yeah. Like, give me some beer. There's Max Verstappen.
There's no stopping Max Verstappen.
Well, there was some stopping today because in the first lap. Yeah,
the opposite happened.
See, the opposite happened today. In the first lap, Lewis Hamilton on a corner there, of course, the aggressive racing, you know, kind of clipped that rear wheel of Max Verstappen's car, send him spinning into the gravel tires.
So was that a legal thing?
Well, I mean, I will tell you that there was a red flag.
Leave it to an attorney to ask that question. Is that legal?
I mean, I can tell you Red Bull was definitely here.
Why did he argue at Perry Einstein?
I mean, it depends on who was in front of who and what was going on.
Well, you know, of course, this was the first lap. So Max Verstappen was in the lead and Lewis Hamilton was right behind him. So this is, you know, 1-2 fight.
He tried to pass him and that's when
And of
happened.
Course, there, you know, Lewis Hamilton was driving very aggressive. And in the first lap, he kind of, they got close and it got clipped Verstappen's rear tire.
Yeah.
Oh, so the other guy was getting around him and hit him.
Yeah, kind of hit
first
him.
First lap was like Austin Powers, that bottle
so
going.
I mean, like, that could invalidate the whole result if he was at fault.
Well, I will tell you, based on the fact that Lewis Hamilton won the race today, I'm assuming that whatever penalty, if there was any penalty for that, then... But actually, there was a penalty. I take that back. It was a 10-second penalty on Lewis Hamilton for that move.
And he still won?
And he recovered from a 10-second penalty to overtake the Ferrari for a lead and actually win the race again.
That's an incredible story.
Just
think about that.
It's I'm going to tell you, for the local fan base who was there, I mean, it was a huge victory for them, you know, to see their homeboy win the race, and so a lot of fans left happy. But of course, if you're, you know, in for the underdog, you know, Max Verstappen, who's been hot, who's been giving Lewis Hamilton a little run for his money, and if you're a fan of, you know, that kind of competition, you know, the fact that, hey, he won the pole position and he got taken out in the first lap. I mean, you don't know.
I mean, that's just completely end of game.
You just don't know. Like, had Max Verstappen stayed in the game, would he have ultimately won? Would he have been on the podium? I don't know. But I can tell you that he's been doing great. He should still be up front as far as points. He's in a good spot as far as standings are concerned. Right. Mm-hmm. Even with this race knocking him out, he's still doing really good in the standings. I did just want to mention, again, Lewis Hamilton in first, Charles Leclerc in second, and Valtteri Bottas in third. So we've got that. So, of course, Mercedes taking the podium with Ferrari. And, you know, that's where we're at.
It's not racist at all, no. Not at all.
It was a high-speed crash. He did walk away from it. Again, that was kind of the highlight of the race there.
YouTube. Maybe they have that on YouTube.
Well, yeah, you might want to check that out.
What the hell is supposed to do, you moron?
All right. That was a great suggestion. And that brings us to the end of the racing segment, pretty much. Unless there's anything. You got two minutes left, so I don't know what you want to do.
We've got 2 minutes left. What else do you got? Wrap up here?
Well, I mean, I guess I can, you know, the only thing really is
Uzi 9mm.
What's going on next week or in a couple weeks here is it looks like we should be having a race in Hungary, of all places.
Getting hungry for Hungary.
Yeah, I mean, this is interesting. So we're going to be in Hungary.
Games
in Budapest. July 30th August 1st.
You pest.
Actually, it's interesting, and I wanted to mention this before we go out to break. Uh-huh. But speaking about that weekend, that specific weekend, July 30th to August 1st, as always, you know, I give ChabDog the exclusivity of my travel plans.
Mm.
And it looks like myself and Dacey, we're going to be flying out to Chicago that weekend and meeting up with Mr. Fleming and Mr. Duggs out at the sports convention, collector convention in Chicago.
Nice.
And so again, unfortunately, we might have another fly session. We're going to see what happens with me. I know the last time I was in New York, and I had to give some sort of expedited racing summary. So hopefully, it won't be the case. But I wanted to let you guys know.
Very grateful for your contribution that time. It was actually turned out to be a wonderful segment. And what a great surprise. We never even expected to have Tank on, so that was even better. What a bonus there. We got to talk to Tank and have both of you on the line and have Tank. Anyway, that worked out great. So I'm sure we'll do it on the fly.
That was a lot of fun.
We'll do it live.
Do it live.
Do it live.
So, of course, I just wanted to throw that in there to let you guys know that we were able to already secure tickets for the convention.
Mm-hmm.
And back, we will be again time, hanging out with the boys.
All right, well, this has really been gnawing at me. I want to get to the break, and then at the other end, you definitely should come out with the clip from Uncle Buck where he's talking to the principal.
You want Uncle Buck on the other side of it?
Yeah,
okay.
with whatever else you want.
We'll fill it in, but as ChabDog said, we are at the break. This is the break now for this week's ChabDog Sports Talk Radio Show. So we're just going to refill our cups and do other things here and go off camera. You know, I snuck out already. But stay tuned. I mean, hey, we'll be playing some good stuff during the break, so you don't want to miss that either. And this time you actually get to see it with our camera link. Don't forget to go to YouTube, to Well Read Productions, and check out today's video footage. Well Read Productions coming up after the break. Have a good time.
We're told that greatness is exceptional when it should be expected. You choose every day to live your life intentionally without apology for how bright your light may shine. So go be great. Go be brilliant. Go be you. Go defy life. The Defy Life movement is one that speaks to each of us in its own way. Defy Life gear speaks to us all by reminding us that one size does not fit all. Visit DefyLifeGear.com to get fitted for greatness.
The Law Office of Brandon S. Chabner, serving clients in Southern California with transactional legal services since 2007. We handle general corporate, outside counsel type work, drafting and negotiating a wide variety of business and commercial contracts, including non-disclosure agreements, independent contractor agreements, and employment agreements. Our experience includes working with public and private companies and involves a broad range of industries, including healthcare, consumer products, real estate, and high technology. Mr. Chabner has over 20 years of legal experience, having worked for some larger national firms and serving as general counsel for a multi-million dollar private company here in Southern California before starting his own legal practice. His educational credentials include a law degree from UCLA, where he was on law review, undergraduate degree at Yale, where he graduated magna cum laude, and an MBA from Harvard Business School. Other areas of focus for Chabner Law include press release and business plan editing, pre-litigation matters, and debt and mortgage resolution work. You can contact us at 310-698-0740 and at bchabner@chabnerlaw.com.
Like ChabDog said, he was 100% right.
He can take all comers.
Ah, Mr. Stay. How do you do, Mr. Gutman?
You begin well, sir. I distrust a man who says Wayne. He's got to be careful not to drink too much, because he's not to be trusted when he does.
Well, sir?
Here's to plain speaking and clear understanding. You're a close-mouthed man?
Oh, I like to talk.
Better and better. I distrust a close-mouthed man. He generally picks the wrong time to talk and says the wrong things. Talking something you can't do judiciously unless you keep in practice. Now, sir, we'll talk if you like. I tell you right out, I'm a man who likes talking to a man who likes to talk.
Swell. Will we talk about the blackbird?
You're the man for me, sir. No beating about the bush. Right to the point. Let's talk about the blackbird, by all means. Professor, answer me a question. Are you here as Miss O'Shaughnessy's representative?
Well, there's nothing certain either way. It depends.
Depends on? Maybe it depends on Joel Cairo.
Maybe.
The question is, then, which you represent. It'll be one or the other.
I didn't say so.
Who else is it?
There's me.
That's wonderful, sir, wonderful. I do like a man who tells you right after he's looking out for himself. Don't we all? I don't trust a man who says he's not.
Now let's talk about the blackbird.
Let's. Mr. Spade, have you any conception of how much money can be got for that blackbird?
No.
Well, sir, if I told you, half, you'd call me a liar.
No, not even if I thought so. But you tell me what it is, and I'll figure out the profit.
You mean you don't know what the bird is?
Oh, I know what it's supposed to look like. And I know the value in human life you people put on it.
She didn't tell you what it is? Cairo didn't either?
He offered me $10,000 for it.
$10,000, mind you, not even pounds. Do they know what that bird is, sir? What is your impression?
Well, there's not very much to go by. Cairo didn't say he didn't. He didn't say he didn't. She said she didn't, but I took it for granted she was lying.
Not an injudicious thing to do. If they don't know, I'm the only one in the whole wide, sweet world who does.
Well, when you told me, that'll make two of us.
Mathematically correct, sir. But I don't know for certain that I'm going to tell you.
Oh, don't be foolish. You know what it is. I know where it is. That's why I'm here.
Well, sir, where is it? You see, I must tell you what I know. But you won't tell me what you know. It's hardly equitable, sir. No, no. I don't think we can do business along those lines.
I'll think again and think fast. I told that gunsel of yours you'd have to talk to me before you're through. I'm telling you now, you'll talk to me today or you're through. What are you wasting my time for? I can get along without you. And another thing. Keep that gunsel out of my way while you're making up your mind. I'll kill him. If you don't, I'll kill him.
Well, sir, I must say you have a most violent temper.
Think it over. You've got till 5 o'clock. And you're either in or out. For keeps!
Six years.
Oh, boy.
Why'd you just make that sound?
I have Tourette's syndrome.
Would you tell the court what that is?
It's a neurological disorder. It causes me to make sounds or say words or twitch in different ways. Sometimes I do it more, sometimes I do it less.
Can you control it?
No. Not for any length of time.
What reason were you given for being discharged, Noah?
They said I was disruptive.
Were you disruptive?
I do market research, and the office I work in, is in the back. And there are only a few co-workers around to hear me.
Did they consider you disruptive?
I don't believe so, no. Nigger!
Why'd you say that, sir?
It's all part of Tourette's.
Noah, would you tell the court what it's like to have Tourette's?
What it's like?
Yeah.
Well, the tics and grimaces start pretty soon after you wake up in the morning. Oh, boy! And then you go about your business when you're alone, you know, hollering and spitting, barking. Oh, boy, bitch! It's pretty weird if you're not used to it, I guess. Oh, boy. Anyway, Tourette's is part of me, and there's nothing I can do about that. About that? What?
Nothing further.
Nothing you can do about that. Tell me, Mr. Fowen, have you ever heard of the drug haloperidol?
Of course I've heard of it.
How about the drug clonidine?
I prefer not to take either of them.
Why? They're both frequently used in the treatment of Tourette's.
Haloperidol, it makes me forget things. It makes me feel totally spaced out. And clonidine, It doesn't work too well with me. Whore, slut, bitch!
Tell me, Mr. Cowan, did you ever call any of your female co-workers bitch?
I wasn't calling them bitch. I was saying bitch.
How do they know the difference, sir?
If they know me, they know the difference.
So the burden of your behavior should be on them, not on you.
Objection.
Burden? Bitch! Let me tell you about burden. A burden is not being able to go into a restaurant or a movie. A burden is... Can
you imagine that?
Americans
is not being able
Act
to
stuff.
Find a woman to love you
he wasn't protected
or an employer
that.
To hire you.
Mr. Cowan, your attorney
a
has made an objection.
Is being the kid in class who everyone pointed at, the nut, the weirdo.
Mr.
I am
Cowan.
A guy with a funny disease, all right? That's all it is. So stop pointing at me and stop treating me like I am crazy. Go, boy, just stop it.
Wow.
Poor guy.
Yeah, for Gassel.
Stop it now. Stop it. Stop it, ChabDog. We're back. Well, we got one more.
I had an irresistible
I'm Anita Horvath.
Impulse to play that clip.
Black melanoma.
And it's been gnawing at me to play this one.
Mm-hmm. Not her wart. I'm the wart. She's my tumor. My growth. my pimple. I'm Uncle Wart. Just old Buck Wart Russell. That's what they call me. Or, melanoma head. They'll call me that. Melanoma head's coming. I'm sorry. Uncle. Maisie Russell's uncle. I'm her uncle. her mother set up this conference with you.
I'm assistant principal here, as you've probably noticed from the indications on the door.
This door?
The outer door.
The outer door?
Yes.
There's nothing on this one.
That's just about enough of that.
Sorry.
I've been an educator for 31.3 years, and in that time, I've seen a lot of bad eggs. I say eggs because at the elementary level, we are not dealing with fully developed individuals. I see a bad egg. When I look at your niece, she is a twiddler, a dreamer, a silly heart. She is a jabberbox. And frankly, I don't think she takes a thing in her life or her career as a student seriously.
She's only six.
That is not a valid excuse. I hear that every day and I dismiss it.
I don't think I want to know a six-year-old who isn't a dreamer or a silly heart. And I sure don't want to know one who takes their student career seriously. I don't have a college degree. I don't even have a job.
Does anyone have a special story to tell a class about something that happened this week? Maisie.
My uncle was microwaving my socks and a dog threw up on the couch for about an hour.
Honest?
Yes.
Why was your uncle microwaving your socks?
Can't get the goddamn washing machine to work.
Blasphemer! But I know a good kid when I see one. Because they're all good kids. Until dried-out, brain-dead skags like you drag them down and convince them they're no good. You so much as scowl at my niece or any other kid in this school, and I hear about it, and I'm coming looking for you. Take this quarter. Go downtown and have a rat gnaw that thing off your face. Good day.
Have Jose Canseco bite off the wart off her face.
Have Jose Canseco.
Go through that again.
Yeah,
he's the rat.
He's a rat.
Jose
Canseco's a rat.
He's a dirty rat.
Oh, the rat reference.
Yeah. That one.
So have Jose Canseco. Bite off the wart
for a quarter. Oof. Okay. Enough of that. We're back.
You know who's also the rat?
We're back.
Who's the rat?
Brad Marchand.
Mmm.
Yeah, the little rat for the Boston Bruins. They call him, I think that's his nickname.
Yeah, actually, you're right.
And think of it. And they had the other guy that was, the other was Whitey Ford. Not Whitey Ford, Whitey Herzog.
Whitey Herzog.
Yeah.
He was the rat.
He has shocking white hair.
Is there Mickey the rat?
The white rat. He was in the white rat.
White rat. The rats we have out there.
Yeah.
Ogner rats.
So this is the second hour where we...
In July.
We really
don't... got through the All-Star break without even mentioning it, by the way. So, I, you know, if I hadn't even brought it up, we wouldn't even talk about it.
Did you watch the All-Star game? Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, because, you know, I want to talk about it because probably me, like a lot of people, did not watch it. So why don't you... And Abe, tell us a little bit about it.
All I know is that the National League won big. It was like 6-1 or 6-2. And
okay.
They just, really I guess exciting. They've got more pitching, and the National League is really pretty loaded when you consider the Dodgers, the Giants, and the Padres. The Padres have had some huge wins. I think they just destroyed a team by like 20 runs a few nights ago. They're quite powerful.
They destroyed.
With the amazing Tatis.
Like John Holmes destroys
They have Fernando Tatis, and he's just so talented at the plate.
John Holmes?
He's got a quick bat, quick bat.
Unfortunately, as much as we love the National League, they ended up losing the All-Star game.
Wait, I heard it was the National League won.
No, the American League, they won 5-2.
Okay, so I misheard that?
It's okay. You know what? I'm giving you credit for the bets from last
I swear week. When I was listening to the highlights on the news, this shows how little I'm paying attention to the All-Star game.
Okay, ChabDog. You succumbed to fake news.
I did?
Well, you did, because you're just repeating what was
reported,
right?
So the American League won. Okay.
The American League won.
So if I told you that communism was good and Christianity is
stupid. The fact is, we got a lot of talent in both leagues, and it's confined to a few teams. And there's quality teams in both leagues that are really talented.
Well,
maybe more so in the American League when you think about it, because you got the A's and the Astros, who are both really strong, and the White Sox, and then you got the Red Sox, and the also-rans are the Yankees and the Blue Jays, and that's and the Mariners, and those teams have talent. So, I guess that makes sense.
Well, I mean, the other thing that I guess the biggest thing to come out of the All-Star game was, of course, a lot of eyes on Shohei Ohtani.
Ohtani, yeah.
From the Angels, interesting enough, I mean...
Did he win the home run derby?
No, he actually
he got knocked
didn't.
Out in the first round.
Yeah, he got knocked
See, you
out
guys
in
are
the
paying
first
more
round.
I am.
But,
well, that was that part.
But Pete Alonso winning the home run derby.
Yeah, he won.
Mm.
So Pete Alonso
he's
Mets,
a stud.
Of course, you know, Frank is losing his mind in New Jersey right now because he's like, oh, my God, the Mets sucks, even though Pete Alonso just won the home run derby.
Well, it doesn't help the Mets, does it? It doesn't help the Mets. Okay, you know, it's time to go over that, what happened last night.
Yeah, because I really like to hear about
Pirates.
That.
So the Mets had a 6-run lead, and they found a way to lose to the Pirates in the worst way possible, on a walk-off grand salami.
Who hit it?
I don't have that information.
You don't even have it?
Hey, dude, you didn't even know it, and you're supposedly a Pirates fan. So.
If I had to guess,
it was a walk-off.
I'd say it was Adam Frazier. Okay. He's had a pretty good year, I think.
Good guess.
The Pirates, if the Bucks turn it around in the year of the Bucks, the Buccaneers and the Pittsburgh, if they were to win the whole thing, that would just be the crowning achievement in this year of the Bucks.
Yeah, so it's the year of the Bucks. So we had Brady, and the Buccaneers started it off in February.
And now we have the Milwaukee Bucks
Bucks.
I agree. The hockey was not a Buck, but the hockey was Tampa Bay, which is kind of weird. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
It was Jacob Stallings. Jacob Stallings.
Jacob
name.
Stallings.
There's a Buck connection there.
Who's Jacob Stallings?
With Tampa Bay and hockey. So
Jacob Stallings the one who hit the walk-off grand slam.
Jacob Stallings.
I have no idea who that is.
Not a huge home run hitter. I think he's like an infielder or something.
So you have heard of him. You know his
second
name.
Second baseman or something.
Okay. Yeah, I mean that's a pretty nice walk-off grand slam to
Was this in Pittsburgh or in New York?
It's walk-off, so it had to be Pittsburgh.
I think this was Pittsburgh.
Oh, man, they must have been going crazy.
Yeah, 5,000 fans, I'm sure they're really happy.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the left fielder did kind of go into the crowds trying to catch the ball. I mean, he made a really good effort in trying to get it done last night. But
sorry.
No cigar. Sorry.
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 More
that's
drama.
Why we have a bottle of... Barstool Sports Pink Whitney here.
In front of the camera,
that's,
if you can.
That's,
which camera are we using?
Okay, here we go. Here we go. Camera right here. Look.
Your camera director. There we go. See, a little lower.
That's why we. That's lower. Why we have a. And the bottle's been they've been we've already kind of started on this.
You know what they say. You know what they say about that, Abe.
That's what we're doing off camera.
They say about that.
What's that?
They say that's from the bar of Barstool.
Oh, actually, I've been to the bar at Barstool. It's actually really nice. It's a very nice bar. It's actually right next to their where they do all their live streams with the couches.
Mm-hmm.
All the live streams there. Yeah, the bar is literally right next to that room right there. Mm-hmm. And it's actually a nice bar. And actually, it's not unusual to find employees actually just working at the bar.
Mm.
It's almost like a Las Vegas casino when you go to the bar and you've got people drinking and they're playing the slot machine that's right there in the bar.
Mm-hmm.
It's something similar, except they have their laptops out and they're actually just working on whatever they're doing for Barstool at the time. But yeah,
drunk and stupid is no way to go through life, sir.
Which is next to the live stream room.
My advice to you,
cool place.
Start drinking heavily.
But wait till ChabDog Sports has their little bar. In the new studio.
Yeah, there's plenty of room for a bar in the new studio.
Across
the street. Yeah, we're moving across the street. That's great. We're going from
two channel to
Bayside.
It's funny. I can't see drinking while I'm in the morning.
Oh, no.
Oh, I've tried it.
No.
It doesn't.
Can't even.
It works for the first few minutes, and then it gets to be unbearable.
I can tolerate it.
Well, if we ever have an event where we're here in the Newport Beach area on a Saturday night or going somewhere, then the bar might come into use for more of the Saturday evening.
For other people.
The Saturday evening. No, for us, you know.
Yeah. I don't know. I still think we should do a screwdriver. We should do a drinking show. We'll just have a screwdriver Sunday show.
It's just, I'd rather do it late in the day.
Well, that would be better, but
when was
the last time you got drunk at a brunch on champagne mimosas, bottomless mimosas? Remember that?
Very irregularly.
There you go, but you've done it. You've done bottomless mimosas. And you'll have one too many because they're free.
I got burned drinking Bloody Marys once, and I've always been kind of poisoned on them since.
Well, then don't have a Bloody Mary. Have a mimosa then. That's a nice team drink for a girl like you.
I was at a sporting event, actually. It's a funny story. And we were stuck in this awful parking jam getting to the stadium, and I was really bored, and we were drinking Bloody Marys in the car.
Mm-hmm.
And I was on my, second or third, and I had the cup with the Bloody Mary sitting there on the dashboard because the car had been stopped for a while in traffic.
Mm-hmm.
And when it started up, my friend, kind of pushed obviously started the car forward, and the cup lurched off of its, it started to wobble.
Okay.
And so the cup actually started to spill, and the cup was in the air, and I hit it with my hand to try to stop it, and
yes.
It went all over everybody.
A nice move.
So can you imagine his
it's not even the flavor of Bloody Mary. It's just the embarrassment you had from that situation.
Well, because I was kind of drunk on a Bloody Mary.
Okay, you're already drunk.
It was just a very sloppy situation.
Okay, sloppy. That's a good way to describe it. So how does that make you feel?
So I'm not going to be drinking a lot of Bloody Marys.
Probably. No Bloody Mary. How does it make you feel when you recall something like that? Just a personal question for you.
Good.
Does it take you to a dark place?
No, good, because that was like one of the real purely fun parts of my life.
Oh,
when I was, in college.
Okay, so spraying everybody with the blood, getting out everyone in their white suits and white shirts covered
in
Bloody
Mary.
This
was law school, actually, and it feels like it was an eternity ago.
Okay.
This was law school. So it was like 25, 26.
Quarter of a century ago, yeah.
You know what? Yeah, it has to be law school. So it just seems like college because
English, motherfucker! Do you speak it?
So much fun.
Mm-hmm.
I was having so much fun.
So that was fun. Okay. Okay, that's fun. That's cool. That was a fun experience.
So, yeah, it's a very good. It's a very, even though it was a bad memory because I pissed somebody off, it was a lot of fun to remember it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, that's good. So, good. So, that's
does that answer your question?
It does answer my question.
Okay. I'm not holding back today because today's Fade Yourself.
Exactly. Exactly. Just do the exact opposite. If it's been leading you places you don't want to be. Yeah, if your practices have been taking you places you want to go, don't fade yourself.
Are we still talking about baseball?
No, we finished up with the Mets and we finished up with the shooting.
What about
you, Abe? You got any more baseball?
Well, You know, the only thing else that we have is
the Mets. The Yankees hitting their Mets, the Red Sox guy in the back.
Yeah, we got. Yeah, we talked about that.
No, did we?
Yeah, it was Alex Verdugo.
I think you talked about that before the show, and now you're. We're just,
no, we talked about that during. It wasn't a green. Hey, we had a green. It's so nice
creatures?
To have a green room again, folks.
We talked about the
bleacher creatures.
We talked about the bleacher creatures.
Yeah, chucking batteries.
The roll call.
Oh, that's right.
The left field.
That's right. That's right.
You're suffering some.
I'm sorry.
Temporary amnesia.
The shit talking at Yankee Stadium. It's on left field. It's left right field. I also like to mention they don't have any fucking nachos there, which is actually a crime.
Well, the bottom line is the Red Sox are doing well. I just want everybody to know they're alive and well. J.D. Martinez is hitting well, and Verdugo's got almost 100 hits, and Rafael Devers is tearing the cover off the ball. And Chris Sale is getting back to being able to pitch again, so watch out.
Yeah. Well, there's some. I do know that
Sale breakdown.
There is some
September. Don't worry.
Some issues with Jacob DeGrom right now. I think he had some tightness in his forearm. So
he stopped throwing for a few days.
Yeah, he's going to be on a little bit of a pause. It just seems like that's a lot of Jacob DeGrom right now.
He needs a little visit from Fook Me. She could loosen that elbow up.
Just seems like.
I
there
thought we
you
already
go.
Played them.
That's something we can
we do. Already no, I know we already played that.
We already
that.
Played that.
Yeah. We can't go back
we
to
already
that.
Played
We never play the same clip twice.
I know, I'm just saying.
That's
I'm
how
just,
we roll.
I'm just saying.
So he needed a little massage.
Or he needs the breakfast.
Just say he's not getting that.
He needs the breakfast of champions. Like the buckwheat breakfast.
The buckwheat breakfast of champions. Good. This is a good segue to that.
There you go.
If I can there
you
it is.
Find it?
Look yeah, we got it. Sounds like it.
Happy holidays and welcome to this special Christmas edition of The Masked Singer. I'm Nick Cannon, and if anyone knows how to beat Eminem in a feud, please let me know. We're joined, as always, by our panelists. Robin Thicke, Jenny McCarthy, Ken Jeong, and Nicole
Scherzinger. Isn't she the one on the Verizon commercials now? The one on the left?
Already out of 10.
I think so.
Thank you, judges.
She's
we have a real special Christmas surprise for y'all tonight and a brand new contestant. So without further ado, please help me welcome our new mystery man, Corn on the Cob.
Full screen.
Figure the words out.
My I tame him falling in love.
It's translated, whatever that is. Sure.
Panelists, any guesses to who could be behind the mask? Robin?
I'm gonna go out on a limb and say that's buckwheat.
That's definitely buckwheat.
Let's see if they're right. Corn on the cob, y'all wanna know. Who are you?
Take it off! Take it off!
Ha! Hey, buckwheat! Remember me?
Oh my god, I'm freaking out, buckwheat. You are my idol!
Thank you very much! Now, buckwheat, I heard you have some more songs for us.
Yes, I sure do. Take a mission!
This is how you learn how to
interpret this. Now I'm running in my nubby drone. Ooh, baby. Yeah, I am.
Sounds good for you.
I know. I got the cherry. But I throw it mud in depth defense. A niece namina. A niece namina. A niece namina. Your felicidad. I am DDD. Find out what me to me. RNF and EDD. Tetan BPP. Talk to me, 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 talk to me. Need a respect. My two, three, four. All the ting lady. All the ting lady. All the ting lady. All the ting lady.
Comfortable diagnosing you as 100% juicy.
Nice.
Ooh, I like being oozy.
Now, what's next for the great buckwheat?
Mel, I suppose it's time for me to go May again.
Buckwheat, wait. We just want you to know we've missed you these past 30 years. We love you, and it's good to have you back.
Oh, thank you very much. But don't worry about Buckwheat. Just remember, wherever I am, I'm doing okay. All tinginated, all tinginated, all tinginated, all tinginated. Oh, 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 oh,
For those of you who don't know who Buckwheat was, here's the real Buckwheat, and here's,
yes,
you know, an abomination, Spanky in blackface, of all people.
Hey, Buckwheat, when's Spanky coming out?
Oh, he's having a powerful lot of trouble. Hey, Buckwheat, you all's getting kind of fat, ain't you?
Love that.
Yes, sir. I've been eating a lot of pork chops. Well, come on, honey lamb.
Pushing baby Darla. Carriages. Yeah, what's that all about? Oh, here, come, here he comes.
Hey, fellas, look!
Stymie.
These kids were all pretty young,
Buckwheat,
aren't they?
Wait a minute.
I don't like the way he said that.
Uh-oh. What is a palm tree? In LA.
Somewhere in LA.
Buckwheat, yeah. Did you say Spanky was in a lot of trouble?
Yes, sir. He's sweating plenty right now.
Well, he'll sweat a lot more if he tries to put anything over on us. But he wouldn't do that, would he?
Oh, no, he likes you all.
Hiya, Buckwheat.
Hiya, Buckwheat.
He wouldn't fool us, would he?
Looks like an Irishman.
Oh, was Spanky like six in that? How old?
I don't know. I wonder how much they got paid. So, I wonder they didn't have to observe child labor laws.
He was so good.
Yeah,
Spanky was.
Actually, they all did a pretty good job, for considering they're just kids.
Yeah, it was
apparently the franchise made money for them too. So,
well, that's good.
Yeah, very good. All right, well, there's your Buckwheat. There's double shot of Buckwheat there. So, tell us some more about the Bucks here. I didn't expect that outcome. I thought the home team was going to win every game. And watching
you bought into that.
Well, and watching Phoenix play in Milwaukee in Game 4. And lose that was a very winnable game for them. It was like that was their game to win, and they just let it go. And like, whatever, we'll just win at home.
I just noticed.
And then that whole narrative got broken last night, Chris, by that victory.
Yeah, Jrue Holiday is playing better. Chris Middleton's playing better.
Mm-hmm.
Holiday was really solid. He doesn't usually score that many points in a playoff game, and he had like 20 something, and then his defense was great, and he's one of these defenders that's really sturdy, and he doesn't go for a lot of fakes, and he stays behind, plays just good fundamental defense. And when Booker tried that move, he just realized that he could take the ball, and he did. Mm-hmm. And Booker had a great game, but the Suns got into this habit of just sitting around watching Booker do his thing,
mm-hmm.
and that's not good for them, because the rest of the guys need to stay engaged, and they weren't. Chris Paul had a pretty good game, but besides that, it was their defense and the lack of distribution on offense that killed them. So Milwaukee knows they can win this now, obviously.
Yeah.
It's they think they're going to win. I would make the Bucks I would say 4-point favorites at home in Game 6.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I'm going to take the Bucks. Like, I think they're going to win by 10.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think, Abe?
Well, I would say that I don't know where the Bucks are going to stand.
Is there a line right now out on that game?
I can look for one.
Yeah.
I'll take a look.
But common sense tells you what you kind of said there, ChabDog. That sounds about right.
Yeah. I mean, it can definitely happen. This happened to the Nets against the Bucks. The Nets won that all-important Game 5 and had a 3-2 lead going. Mm-hmm. Then they went... Yeah, they went back to... but they, so the Nets were in a better position. Were the Bucks in the same position then that the Suns are in now? Mm-hmm. The fact is they're both down 3-2, and they could come. The Suns could come back from this, but it's going to take... It's going to be really tough now. It's going to be really tough. So
well, they got to win two in a row.
Yeah, but just winning that one in Milwaukee.
And they got to win one in Milwaukee. Well, hey, but Milwaukee won one in Phoenix.
I'm just scared by all those people outside in the Deer District that are going crazy. That's growing.
They're going to riot in a good way. Aren't they?
Probably.
Yeah.
They're going to go crazy. It's been 50 years.
They'll go crazy. Let's see what,
You want to play Buck
Owens? Something completely different. Yeah, let's play Buck
Owens. I love this clip. Reed.
This is a great clip. For those of you who remember the show to Hee Haw, just before I play it here, this was something when Brandon and I were kids. This was popular on TV for the Hillbilly set amongst us, which there were a lot more of us, a lot more of them back mm-hmm. then than there are today, that's for sure. A lot more, enough that they got their own TV show weekly. Jerry Reed from Smoking the Bandit.
That's
great.
But that's a slap in the face to Phoenix.
Hey, Jerry.
Yeah.
Have you been out to Opera Land yet?
Yeah, and you wouldn't believe the crowd. Huh. I said to this one woman, have you ever seen such confusion? And she said, well, mister, you ought to know you're in the ladies' room.
Good, isn't it?
Jerry, yes. You want to come with me tonight to a lecture at the auditorium? It's on sex appeal.
Hmm.
No thanks. Already gay.
I love that dog. I love that dog.
Yeah. Oh, dog.
Great bloodhound.
The great bloodhound.
He's a good boy.
Hey, Jerry, what time is it by your watch?
It's exactly 10:02.
10 to what?
I don't know. Times was tough. I had to lay off one of the hands.
That's so clever. There's blinds behind there. Jerry! That might be bad either.
Boy, you look like you could need a... You look like you need a haircut, man. Have you tried Archie's barbershop yet?
Yes, matter of fact, I had. I was over this afternoon, but his hands was dirty. I just wouldn't let him cut my hair.
Dirty hands? How disgraceful, Archie. Who ever heard of a barber with dirty hands?
Well, it wasn't my fault. It just so happened at that particular time nobody had asked for a shampoo.
Good luck to the Bucks. I wish the Bucks all good luck. I'm sure you gentlemen do.
Well, there and other, you know, going back to the Mets, you know, the, Francisco Lindor is also on a 10-day injured list as well. So that's not really good. He's actually on a 10-day injured list with a grade 2 oblique strain.
Oblique.
Yeah, so he apparently, you know, Lindor's, this is really kind of the first real injury that's really taken him out for, you know, this amount of time. And so that's kind of, you know, that's kind of disheartening thinking, really, you know, he's got like this massive 10-year contract with him. And it's just hard to imagine. And again, you know, I spoke to Frank about this. It's like, how do you have 10-year contracts? I mean, so much can happen in 10 years.
You know? Does have insurance cover any of this?
Well, I'm sure, but
yeah, there must be somebody must have written a policy there somewhere. Yeah, paid a premium. Yeah, this would have been
somehow covered. This risk is not being
not borne by the team. Maybe the player the gets team, some kind of.
But it's not unreasonable maybe. To the team.
But it just seems like a lot of contracts are going into this 10-year mark.
Yeah,
yeah.
And it, and that's just like crazy because you know so many things can happen in one.
It means
season.
Some insurance company's making money. So what I would say is buy insurance company stocks.
All right, let's do that.
Yeah, they never go wrong.
Let's go. Not let's really. Go with a little.
Not that I'm. Yeah, I'm not providing or giving any investment advice whatsoever.
They're all backed up by everybody else. There's this huge. No, there's this huge like pool to support any kind of situation when the insurance companies go bankrupt.
Yeah, similar to the FDIC for the banks, the insurance companies have their own fund that takes care of any irregularities that occur to smooth out the balances there.
Yeah.
And it's been so successful.
My grandfather knew that.
It's been decades and decades and decades since the insurance company failed.
I have to start following his teachings.
It's just diversification. You know, you can have some money in the stock market, but don't keep it all in there. I particularly like the fixed index annuities. They're a wonderful product.
Okay. We don't talk about financial stuff very often.
Yeah, here we go.
We should sometime tap into that brain of yours involved with investment banking.
Mm-hmm. And, of course, I'm not providing any investment advice whatsoever. No. That can only be sought through sitting in front of a licensed individual. You should never take advice over the radio from anybody.
No.
Be they licensed or not.
And,
I'm licensed,
and maybe
so I'm
don't
not
don't do the opposite any of your instincts. That's probably not a good idea.
For a small part of your portfolio, it could be a great idea to go a contrarian. That's how portfolios are designed.
One of the
parts
hardest
of
things
are
is
exactly
to know
contrarian.
When to sell.
That's the hardest thing, yeah. Putting a contrarian position in is fine. Yeah, doing the
that's
opposite
is fine. That's
what you
really pay your broker for.
Yeah, it's knowing when to sell.
I have to make that
take
kind
your
of decision soon. And so, you
and
know,
reposition.
I'm happy I have somebody I can kind of rely on.
Well, I like options that give me returns without having even to make those decisions. Those ones are even better.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But unless you like the choices, yeah, unless you like those choices, it's different.
Well,
but you chose law.
I did.
You want a career in
it
seemed law?
Kind of cool at the time, and watching this show brings back some nice.
And what was your second choice? If you didn't go to UCLA, where would you have gone?
I got into Northwestern.
Oh, that's a tough choice there.
I went to Northwestern, and it looked a lot like New Haven in February. It was pretty depressing.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, that's a tough choice.
I have my heart set on UCLA in Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm. You made a good choice.
But you made an excellent choice.
And then you watch this show, and all these women with their shoulder pads on, and
this is the 80s, right? Late 80s. This is corporate.
They've got narrow ties, narrow lapels.
Very conservative back then.
Very. Good hair.
Oh, amazing hair.
The gal from the Partridge Family.
What did you like about these characters? Like, I like the fact that Michael Cusack was... he was always eating something.
Well, he's a big cast here.
He
cost a lot of money.
They had him eating things during...
Yeah, this guy went on to do stuff. Jimmy Smith's...
Oh, he did a lot of
Michael
stuff.
Michael Tucker was Bagel in Diner.
Oh, yeah.
That was a good character.
Wow, this is cast.
And Blair Underwood, he was a great actor. I don't know.
Oh, yeah. This guy did plenty.
Yeah.
And plus, they always had great intros, right?
That was a good opening, wasn't it? That guy does a good score.
Oh, that's and yet there's more. What's this?
Mike Post.
Oh. That's the person who produced it. Put it on. Thank you, TVs, from TV's Greatest.
Yeah, it was well done.
Together. Yeah, well done.
So is this show, Hill Street Blues.
Yeah, we just have the music. I'll throw the music on in the background.
Yeah.
We can reminisce. This came That's on it. After Magnum, I think.
On Tuesdays?
Yes.
Was it Tuesdays?
Well, yes. Yes, I think it was Tuesdays. Yeah,
I feel like it was on Monday. Yeah, I feel part of me feels
it's
like
Tuesday
it was
or Wednesday.
Tuesday at 8 o'clock.
Tuesday or Thursday.
Or 9 o'clock.
Sounds about right.
It was probably... It was...
9 o'clock. Yeah, because Magnum would be on at 8.
How about any Three's Company?
Oh, you think so, huh?
Three's Company.
You like that?
That was kind of later.
Is that how you roll?
That's
the TV show.
Three's Company was the early 90s.
Early 90s? No, that's 80s. That's early. That's 10 years earlier. That's early 80s. For sure. In fact, isn't that 70s?
I want to think it was still.
No, it's late. It's late 70s. No way.
Okay, you're right.
Yeah,
you're right.
Way.
I got a few old
cheers. I'm thinking cheers.
Cheers made the transition.
I remember Cheers.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I used to watch that all the time with my wife.
Yeah, Cheers.
I like the earlier episodes were better, but once Shelley Long was gone,
yeah,
was gone.
I didn't like, Shelley Long did it for me. The other one didn't.
Yeah.
Sometimes you wanna go where everybody knows your name.
I saw a really crazy movie last night.
What was that?
We've had some clips on before. The movie makes no sense. Uh-huh. It's completely ridiculous.
Oh, and, boy.
But in some ways, it's a lot of fun to watch. It's this thing called Brewster McCloud.
Oh, Brewster McCloud.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've never seen it before, but John Candy's in it, so it can't be that
bad.
It
has John Shuck in it as the policeman. Mm-hmm. He's chasing Shelley Long when she's in her car, crazy car sequence.
Shelley
Duvall.
Shelley Duvall, thank you.
Yes.
Big difference.
I always mix them up, but yeah, one's a lot more annoying. Duvall is very annoying.
Really? You don't like her as Popeye? You didn't like her in The Shining?
She's annoying in a good way.
Okay. So annoying can be good.
She's in a lot of movies I like, but I don't like her. But she actually does a pretty good job.
So you and her alone on a desert island?
I don't know. Maybe I'd really like her, but there's something about her that...
There's a chance you could. There's a chance.
Rubs me the wrong way.
Okay, well, you just don't know her personally.
But I know she's had some sex. She had a sex scene in Brewster McCloud.
Did she?
Yeah. That kid came on to her and...
Wow. Did she make him a man?
She made him into a man, I guess.
Oh, my goodness. That's more than I want to know. Thank you.
Yeah. This had a... We have the clip from Hill Street Blues with Sergeant Benedetto, don't we?
Yes, we have that, too.
Dennis Franz.
Yeah, 10:45. Let's do that.
Yeah.
This was a weird clip. Excuse me. This is a weird clip, so let's...
The oral exam.
The oral exam, yeah, literally.
You're not a hands-on kind of personnel officer.
You got that right.
Yeah, but we've been through 7 khakis in the last 3 weeks. Maybe 8's the magic number.
Lieutenant, the people that we're getting from this guy Pearson and department personnel just ain't qualified. I'm not sure this Ms. Dolan took the exam.
Check her records.
Yeah. Says that she took the exam, but the day after that incident with Daryl Walden's father, she was...
Dennis Franz.
You want to know what I think?
Or the other guy.
Only if
the
I don't have to do anything about it.
I believe... The job opportunities are being offered in return for certain favors.
Mm. Favors?
Favors.
Yeah, what kind of favors?
Of a sexual nature.
Uh-oh.
So, you figure Pearson's turning these ladies over before he turns them off?
It's certainly not a subject that I want to broach with the man, but that's my guess, correct?
Well, I guess maybe this is the kind of thing I should look into.
I wish you
He's
would.
Gonna look into it personally.
Tell Ms. Dolan,
I'd like
to give
us a personal attention.
I appreciate that.
Personal attention.
Hey, I'm the personnel officer. I'm looking through your app file, Ms. Dolan, and I find the grade, but no copy of a test.
Well, Mr. Pearson gave me the examination orally.
I see. And where did this oral exam take place?
In a hot tub.
She's honest.
Got a hot tub?
No, we went to the Bubble Your Pleasure spa.
Bubble Your Pleasure.
It's pretty clear what happened, isn't it? Do you like playing cat and mouse, making me feel dirty?
Hey.
Feel dirty.
Here, go on. Give it a blow. Get her dry cleaned.
Give it a blow.
What kind of
blow?
I'm not making any moral judgments.
He's done playing games with words.
I got to get the facts.
Can you imagine her eating a banana?
So, after the exam,
on the yak, it's less than 10 seconds.
Dance with no steps.
For eating a banana?
I'm afraid so.
Well,
somebody next morning, swallowed that. You wake up.
A girl or a guy?
Qualified.
The next morning.
Okay.
Try 5 minutes.
5 minutes?
She's got skills.
Like a kid with candy, huh?
What is that supposed to mean? I can't take this.
Yeah.
Hey, take it easy, Ms. Dolan.
I'm not qualified.
No,
I shouldn't have this job.
Look.
But I don't need to take any pinch and tickle.
Hey, I'm just making a little joke here, all right? I mean, we know you ain't no Mary Freak of Poppins there, you know?
Mm-hmm. Uh-oh.
That is it. I quit.
Hey, look. Hey, don't get upset.
Mary Freak.
Listen, I'm just fooling around with you, right?
Oh, jeez.
Just having a good...
Fooling around, eh?
Lieutenant Norma Bunce, Mr. Pearson, personnel officer, Hill Street.
Phone's out?
No, the phone ain't out, and don't crack wise with me, Pearson.
What's our problem?
Our problem is that you've been sending us morons to be our khaki officers, which me and my duty sergeant couldn't figure out until Ms. Dolan told us a little story about how she got to be qualified after you gave her a little oral exam down at the Bubble Your Pleasure hot tub salon.
He did it.
Yeah.
Mutt. You're in it up to your lips, Pearson. You could be going away.
So is she under the water?
Like, no. Falsification of records, solicitation to commit lewd and immoral acts.
Lewd, all right.
God. Oh, God is correct there, Pearson. You better get your mind right.
What do you need?
I need khakis that can write their own names, and preferably some other people's.
You got it.
And starting today, Ms. Dolan, she left us.
I'll have someone there at 2. Right. Lieutenant, all this stuff about going to jail.
Just do your job, all right?
Would you want to help me with my screening procedure? I'm just thinking, you know, if you had a hands-on interview.
What are you suggesting here?
Oh, I just want to be able to satisfy your exact needs.
Our exact needs are we don't need any more airheads.
Tell you what, I'll send the candidate up there. She'll understand that it's subject to your interview approval. Now, all things being equal, Lieutenant, give me a sense in terms of physical appearance.
He looks, look at this. He's going against his exact, he's going against, he's doing the opposite.
Lieutenant, loosen up. What do you want to see in a woman?
Well, you'll deliver anything.
Tell you one thing. I think this country's too hung up on thinness.
Yeah.
Send me something. With some
something
meat.
With some meat on it. Like, yeah.
You know, I'm guilty of slapping the meat when I go to the grocery store. I go, look you at glow. These big thighs.
What was his name? Sergeant? So is he a sergeant? What was it?
Sipowicz? Is that Sipowicz?
Andy Sipowicz.
Yeah, that's right.
I had a different name in him. Yeah, so Sipowicz is a chubby dice. Chaser.
Yeah.
Chubby chaser. Send it to me a little thick. Send me those candidates a little bit on the thick yeah. side.
Yeah, we like them big here.
I like women like my milkshake. Mm. Thick.
This was back in the days when we had answering machines, so people could leave you messages. Now at home answering machines.
Remember when jokes would come?
Like the home number now is like the it's
oh, there's no home number.
It's the refuge that's you know for messages that will never find a listener.
For 2 decades.
I mean, so there must be a lot of the people like me that I can't check all my messages at my home number.
You have a home number?
I do. I have a landline. Yeah.
You do? Abe, do you have a landline?
Yes, we do have a well, I'm going to tell you.
So I'm the odd person out. Okay, there you go.
Well, you know, the landline, I think it's, you know, it helps with, you know, anytime we go to, let's say we're going to enter something into a raffle or do something, we put the landline there.
I just like having a landline that works besides a cell phone.
Mm-hmm.
But it has to do with the size of your business and things, I think, but,
Well, that's different. No, business.
The nature of your business.
Understandable, but for you.
So, I guess. You used to have answering machines like this where you could just fill them up. Like, let's hear what this one was filled up with.
Well, dude, it's, you have anything else to say about the Rockford Files too? I mean, it's a pretty cool show.
Oh, but this, we can talk over it. I mean, okay. this was the
hold
reason.
Hold on, here's a phone ringing. Yeah, nobody knows what this sound. You know what that sound is?
Opening of this.
Does Abe know what that is?
That's a telephone.
Yeah. At the tone, leave your name and message. I'll get back to you.
Jimmy, this is Angel. Listen, I got this new pad right over by the Hollywood Freeway, and some friends are coming.
Hollywood Freeway.
Fire your record player.
Jim, this is Donna. Boy, we really can swap today. Oh, sit. We should be calling about... Sit. I'll meet you in... Oh, get down.
It's ChabDog.
From up the street. I'm phoning all the neighbors because Spotty is loose. If you see him, call me. Oh, don't wear musk cologne. Leopards have a thing about that.
This is Globe Publications. Our records show you did not return your free volume of the Encyclopedia of Weather. So we'll be sending you the remaining 29 volumes. You'll be billed accordingly.
Jimmy, Lou, you owe me $5. Matarazzo's average in the 68 series was 310, not 315. Oh, and Fran and I are getting divorced.
Mr. Rockford, Sue Ellen, our class is having that crazy scavenger hunt I told you about. If you're wondering what happened to your trailer door, it's going to win me first prize.
Hey, I saw your ad in a classified. 3 African goats for sale. I keep calling. All I get's a machine. Is that a typo in the paper or what?
Hey, am I too late for those African goats? Haven't got the whole 300 cash, but like I got a lot of homemade cheese. Maybe we could work something out.
So you've put your machine on at night, huh? Just because I call you at 3 a.m.? You know how bad my insomnia is. Thanks a lot, Jim.
Jim, this is Manny down at Ralph's and Morrow's. Some guy named Angel Martin just ran up a 50-buck bar
Angel.
Tab. Now he wants to charge it to you.
Yeah.
You gonna pay it?
Angel.
Hi there. If you're interested in selling your product via computerized telephone sales, stay on the line, and one of our representatives will speak with you.
Jim, it's Grace at the bank. I checked your Christmas Club account. You don't have $500. You have $50. Sorry, computer foul up.
Hey, Jimmy, I tried to catch you before you left. Hey, buddy, I was wrong. That rally in Mexico? That was yesterday.
Jimmy Scott? This is Aunt B from Tulsa. Cousin Randy just graduated high school and wants to be a movie producer. Now, you live out in Hollywood, you just do something.
Jim, I have finally finished 12 long years of psychotherapy, and I'm now able to tell you just what I think of you.
Uh-oh.
Would you please call me?
This is Mrs. Owens with the Association for a Better Malibu. Thanks for your contributions. We made great strides, but it would help, dear, if you could move your trailer.
Here's the tally, Jimbo. You had Atlanta at even money, tough break, and you got bombed in the Duke Wake Forest fiasco, and you split the Quinnell at Holly Park, so you had the book $4.50. Anytime before Friday, huh, buddy?
Bill Skelly with ICO. Like to interest you in some new private detection equipment, including the 440A telephonic bug. We'll demonstrate it in a friend's home for one
sounds
full
like
week
Humphrey Bogart
at no charge.
Okay, Jimbo. Right. Dennis, I know you're in there, and I know you
that's
know it's ticket
Dennis
season
it's
again.
Listen,
ball and all that. So come to the door when I knock this time. Exactly. I know you're in there.
That number 4 you just picked up from Angela's Pizza? Some scouring powder fell
only
in there.
Only one I haven't heard
you
is
don't eat it.
Richie Brock.
Hey, I hope you try your phone machine before dinner.
Isn't he on here?
Good morning. This is the telephone company. Due to repairs, we're giving you advance notice that your service will be cut off indefinitely at 10 o'clock. That's 2 minutes from now.
This is Jim Rockford. At the tone, leave your name and message. I'll get back to you.
Okay.
Interesting. So, interesting little fact on that clip, which you probably didn't even notice, was that the phone number there was actually interesting. It was like a 333 number, and those are actually fictitious phone numbers. There,
11.
They use it. They use that 555 number in phone numbers as a fake.
Well, they don't want to use anybody's actual number.
Yeah, but it's always interesting, you know? That little movie.
There's a legal reason for that, I think.
Fascinating.
You don't have permission to do that or something, but
11.
I guess. I don't know. I don't know, actually. But there must be a reason why they have a fake number. That
so 333 is like a 555. It's just a fake number.
So this number was 311-555-2368. So when any time we are using that 555 there, it's kind of those range of numbers that specifically
that's
made
the telltale
for,
sign.
Those are the telltale signs. A little behind the scenes here with
hey, Dick fucking Tracy.
Yeah, I'm Dick fucking Tracy. Dick damn fucking, right I am.
Yeah, come to think of it, I don't know if I've. Is there any number you've ever seen with the three numbers there in that position the same?
Well, I don't know if I've seen 555. I mean, I can tell you. I only know the Jacobian Myers one.
Except 555.
I know 888.
Two used to be directory assistants.
Yes, areas. It did.
Whatever area code. So you plug in the area code. Area code 555-1212 was out of state directory.
So
assistants.
It's
way back in the day.
Maybe that was phased out.
You pay someone to look it up, and then be charged to your account. Yeah, that's old school. There's some old school.
I don't remember what that was for.
It was expensive, yeah. It was the phone company offered it, and it was out of area.
Well, and what did it allow you to do?
Out of area directory assistance. And so you just go to that, and you say, "I want."
You want to get somebody's number.
First Interstate Bank.
Yeah, without having to talk to the operator.
Yeah, and it would bring up that number. And say, "Do you want to dial it?" And you say, "Yes." And it would just dial it and connect you right with that, without even having to punch it in. Yeah,
kind of like a self-service operator.
At 40 cents a pop.
Self-service operator
or more.
Yeah, when's the last time? Vary. Yeah, I mean, when's the last time you talked to an operator on the phone?
2007, maybe. Maybe earlier.
Just think about that.
Well, Abe, have you ever talked to an operator on the phone?
Well, you know, I want to say I only get an operator when I'm calling like a phone number that has some sort of directory on it. Sometimes it'll say press 0 to connect with the operator, but usually the operator is somebody who works for that company. Honestly, I don't know if I can actually remember a time when I actually spoke to the telephone's operator. Jeez, I don't even know if I ever...
The area code is 201.
What would long-distance service be without long-distance operators? Without operators to help you with collect calls, person-to-person calls, operator-assisted calls. We know this. It wouldn't be AT&T.
Too bad we didn't have Brian on.
Cliff Robertson.
Operator service. Call anywhere, anytime, over a century of commitment. That's AT&T.
Oh,
the more
great.
You hear, the better we sound. We challenge
someone. Yeah, and they were ubiquitous at one time.
Reach out and just say hi.
Now they're gone. They're vanished. I knew people who worked for Bell Canada when I lived in Canada, and they were... Yeah, they worked for telephone operators for their whole careers and stuff.
That's crazy.
I know.
Can you imagine walking on a switchboard your whole life? That's nuts.
Well, you pick up a phone and dial, and you press
just
zero.
Say hi.
And connect you to the operator, and operator. And it's like, okay. And they'd have a headset on, operator. And
route your call out, huh?
Yeah.
Do
yeah.
whatever they do, huh?
Yeah,
I mean, what was the need for that?
Overseas, you couldn't direct dial a lot of overseas places at that for years. Yeah, that was not.
So you went to zero, and you spoke to the operator and says, I need to connect. Overseas to this number?
To that. And then there were a lot of radio telephone services available. So if you're talking to somebody, you know, for whatever reason, they're using radio telephone instead, that had to be an operator place call.
Mm. Interesting.
And then, back then you could also charge collect calls. And because long distance was so expensive, they allowed you to go person to person. So that until the person got on the line, you didn't have to pay. So you'd say, I want to make a person-to-person call, either direct, collect or not, to John Smith. And so you call up, and like his mother would answer, and she'd say, no, he's not here right now. You wouldn't have to pay for that. Otherwise, if you called without that, you'd be paying. So you use an operator to avoid being charged if you can't get person-to-person. Because they're charging like $5, or the equivalent of probably $5 or $10 a minute today.
I just
really
feel
expensive.
I just feel like if we had operators today, people would be calling them as therapists.
That a lot of that happened back then, too.
Right? Be like, how's your day going today? Great, thank you. Mm. And then just keep going.
They call for therapy. They call to abuse them. Telephone prankers
sometimes
like
I
me
connect with
would abuse them. And then they take the phone
it's
off.
It's always nice when on any level when you connect with like a customer service person.
When you connect,
company.
And it's nice, yeah.
When you have a human experience and they help you out or they do something for you. And,
get out.
I just hope everybody has that kind of a week next week because we didn't talk about the British Open. I think that was one.
Thank goodness.
I don't know what's happening. It's at Royal St. George, I think, and Oosthuizen was winning as the day started. That's all I know.
Okay.
So what do you want to go out with here? We're at the end of the show.
We are at the end of the show. Let's see what we got left here. We got some good things left here. Yeah, we can... Let's get around. I think this is a great one. Let's do this.
Okay.
This is a great clip of it, too.
Right.
I'm so glad we have TV to watch it here, that all of our fans can see this. And remember, look this up on YouTube. We'll have this posted. We'll put the link in.
What goes around comes around. And it's
been a great experiment. I can't wait to see what we look like.
When I get around to looking at this video, I'm sure I'm going to love it. Mm-hmm. So thank you, Abe, for help making this day possible.
Yes.
Well, I mean,
you.
And your wife.
You know, I just
Daisy, our new
and a wacky hot mess who's over there.
Intern.
Didn't really participate this week, but that's okay.
She's right. You made her right.
She ran off.
Well, okay. I would say that one of the things that really is amazing was the fact that we had this wonderful studio here at Newport Beach, and of course, anytime we can share that with the audience, it's just kind of nice because it's such a pleasurable place to be, and it's so cool. And you know what's even crazy to think is that this is really nice as it is, but we're moving into something even bigger and better, and that's amazing. It's like holy crap! It was already amazing as it is, and now we're just moving on to bigger and better, and it's just amazing. ChabDog Sports is on rocket boosters here, just blasting out into outer space.
Well, Abe, it's because we get around.
Yeah, and we're not the Beach Boys, but you might be able to call us the Newport Beach Boys.
There we go, the Newport Beach Boys.
We are the Newport Beach Boys.
Here are the Beach Boys.
Yeah, take it away.
Year round, year round, year round.
The Trevor Bauer ballad. The Ballad of Trevor Power.
Down the same old strip, I gotta find a new place where the kids are hip. My bunnies and me, you're getting real well known. Yeah, the bad guys know us and they leave us alone. I'm getting around, 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 I get around, 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 I get car, 'cause it's never been beat, and we've never missed yet with the girls we meet. None of the guys go steady, 'cause it wouldn't be right to leave the best girl home now on Saturday night. Get around, I get around, yeah, get around, round.